one of the most important resources that we have to keep in mind is water.
To make a trail sustainable, you have to be dialed into where water is flowing and where water is coming from and what it affects systematically.
Trail systems, as they develop, if they're not developed in a sustainable way, have the potential to deliver a lot of sedimentation into your streams. So that's where a lot of the sustainable trail building best practices and guidelines come into play. Creating trails that try to lay lightly on the land and reduce the amount of sedimentation that ends up in your streams.
Lots of this information exists in mapping, GIS has layers, but the reality is that data is really coarse. So we're purposed with taking a finer look at on the ground evidence and trying to avoid areas of conflict.
Bat mitigation is really big here on the East Coast. We've had a sharp decline in bats. The northern long-eared bat is the most common one people hear. And so bats roost in trees, and like they'll roost in crazy trees, like small trees. It's not just like big dead trees that they roost in. And so during bat, when they're raising their family and their youngs, you know, we don't want to be cutting down potential bat roost trees, stuff like that.
We're not plowing through healthy stands of trees if we don't have to. That's the beauty of trails, we're flexible. There's a wetland in an area that we need to get through. We're not gonna go through the wetland, we're gonna go around and work on the edge of that wetland.
The primary one I think about is looking at the soil and the rock. And the soil is really gonna dictate what you can do with the trail. Can you push the limits and put some bigger features? You're gonna need certain types of soil for that. So, and that really impacts the trail builders when they start building, but when we're planning and designing, we're looking for those opportunities of, can you do it in this place?